increasingly. The first is the position of piracy. The position of piracy is whether you grant me the freedom or not, I will exercise the freedom. And this is how most people in India access culture, access software. If you go to the website of Business Software Alliance, it's a lobbying group for Microsoft and other proprietary software vendors, they will tell you that 82% of computer users in India pirate software. Without permission from the copyright holders, they use the software, they modify the software, etc. So that is the piracy position. I'm sure in this room, the number of pirates will be much lower because you're not Indians, you're much more wealthier Italians. But the future in Italy is very different. I had the good fortune to visit a school the other day with the cluster team, and I raised my hand and asked people in the classroom, how many of you pirates buy illegal DVDs? And I was certain about 80% of the young people put their hands up. So piracy is something that normal citizens usually take as part of normal activity on the internet. If you were to tell a young person that you have to use the internet, but you can't download video and you can't download audio, then they will look at you very strangely. They will think that you have lost your mind. Let's go further, and a more radical position than the piracy position. But before we do that, let us understand the piracy position a little more clearly. One condition which is common to Creative Commons, GNU GPL and BSD is the condition of attribution. You can modify, you can use, you can share, etc., but you must give attribution. There is no negotiation on that. And pirates usually give attribution. If somebody were to pirate a James Bond film, Quantum of Solace, then they usually say it's a James Bond film. The pirate rarely puts his own name on the product because nobody would buy it in that case. So even though piracy looks like a radical position on intellectual property, they're still conservative in the sense that they insist on attribution, or at least in the daily practice, they do provide attribution. So now let us look at the position of Kiran Subbaiah, a new media artist in Bangalore. And one of his recent works was a license agreement. And it's a very interesting license agreement. He says, once you have bought this product, or once you have taken this artwork from me, you have the right to produce any artwork and put my name on it. You also have the right to take any of my artworks and put your name on it. So what he has managed to do is dismantle the last element of intellectual property, which is attribution. Let's move on. So when we hear talk about the IP mainstream, that is what WTO and what copyright holders would like us to believe, they argue for a common regime on intangible property across the globe. When we hear the arguments of free software advocates and Creative Commons advocates, they also argue for a common IP alternative that applies uniformly across the globe. This is very strange. This is not how other regimes of rent and property work. If you were to look at the regime of rent on capital, the interest rate in Japan is not the same as the interest rate in India, is not the same as the interest rate in Italy, because in each country, the market is configured differently. A certain proportion of the market has capital, another proportion of the market doesn't have capital, and the interest rate has been configured carefully to ensure that capital moves across these two parties. That is why interest rates are configured differently across each country. Let's look at tangible property. If you were to rent an apartment in the city that I come from, Bangalore in the south, you have to give 10 months of rent in advance as deposit. If you rent an apartment in New Delhi, the capital of India, you give only 2 months of rent in advance. Within the same country itself, there is no common regime on tangible property. The regime changes from state to state, from city to city. So My argument is that asking for the common application of one IP regime, whether it is the maximalist regime that the World Trade Organization and WIPO, etc., want us to adhere to, or the alternative regime, which is free software and creative commons, is too simple a solution. The regime on intangible property must be configured based on the balance between intangible labor and tangible labor in each economy. You can't prescribe a uniformly applicable solution.